Welcome back to Ask the Educator, a podcast for all professionals involved in medical device processing and sponsored by Healthmark Industries. The education team here at Healthmark has 280 years of combined experience in areas ranging from sterile processing, endoscopy, OR, biomed, to hospital and industry leadership. Our goal is to leverage our collective experience to answer one of your questions each episode, giving you the practical tips you need to succeed in the evolving world of device processing. My name is Kevin Anderson, clinical educator here at Healthmark, and I will be your host. Let's get started. Hello, everyone. Kevin Anderson here, your host for this episode of Ask the Educator. This will be a little different than normal as we have a special guest educator joining me, Rod Parker, Senior Principal Scientist with Stryker Instrument Division, is with me. So thank you for joining me, Rod. I appreciate it.
No problem, Kevin. Thank you very much.
For this episode, we wanted to get into the story behind Blue 62, the surfactant detergent from Stryker. Now, I'm really excited to talk about this because I have some history with Blue 62. I was skeptical of this product initially in my former role as manager, but I agreed with the local rep to do a trial. And it was like hands down the favorite of the entire group for manual cleaning. Obviously, we didn't do anything other than manual with it. But I just thought it was interesting because here's this one, the only product actually that I was aware of that wasn't enzymatic based. And we're always talking about enzymes. And not that there's anything wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with it, really. But then here comes the surfactant product and everyone just loved it. You know, like, where did this come from? And I don't have to monitor temperature. Dosing is real easy. Like, wow, man, this is great. Checks all the boxes, you know?
Yep. Well, you're very true. Because that's, you know, one of the concepts with this was it was, I guess the best way to put it is this project started for me anyway. I am the scientist. I am one of the scientists here in the instruments division. And one of the primary products I deal with is powered equipment. And people who knows anything about powered equipment, not only does it have probably the most amount of materials in one particular product. So when you actually take a piece of equipment and take out all of the pieces that it's made out of, you know, a piece of powered equipment, you know, has all kinds of different parts and pieces in it that even though they may not be exposed directly to the patient or to the surgical field, you know, internally, they can be very affected by a lot of different things. And one of those is primarily grease. And because you can't move anything unless it has grease on it if you're doing a powered piece of equipment. So, you know, this whole Blue 62 story started, it started back in 2004, actually, with me.
So how long has it been on the market?
It's been on the market since 2011 in some form. It was originally marketed as a product called ProClean.
Yes, that's right.
ProClean. It got changed to Blue 62 primarily when we made the pre-treatment product, which came out after somewhere in, I think, 2013 or 14. But the rebranding was just mainly something with the fact that if people have seen, you know, there are other products called ProClean on the market. So to get away from any kind of confusion as to what it was made of or anything, the marketing department came up with a new name. So when people tell me sometimes they say, well, you know, I've only seen Blue 62 since like 2014 or 15. It's like, well, no, actually, you got to go back to the name ProClean. And if you've seen ProClean,
you're absolutely right. Yeah, yep. I automatically, now it's Blue 62 in my mind, mm-hmm. but I do remember it as ProClean. That's right.
Yeah. And it's amazing you said that the staff found it very useful. One of the things, and being a scientist, I'm not an R&D person, you know, by profession. In other words, I have an engineering background, but I don't necessarily have, you know, development work with me. I've basically been the science guy. I used to be able to tell people most of the time in the central sterile community was, you know, if there was something wrong with your instructions or something that it wasn't cleaned right, it was probably my fault because I probably didn't make it right. But in this case, what happened was being assigned to the new project for, you know, why we were having issues with getting things either clean or having things be affected, primarily the greases and the tools. you know, I went and I contracted with a bunch of people, some experts in the field, some guys that worked with the national laboratories down in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, fellow that worked for DuPont directly, fellow that worked with Dow Chemical directly, and put this little bit of consulting team together and basically went and said, you know, why are these happening, and what can we put together? What kind of products can we put together that would work, you know, chemicals that you can put together that would help, you know, get these products clean? And one of the aspects that we found out very quickly, being in mainly orthopedic type based perspective, we found that a lot of the detergents that were made were primarily made to clean the protein-based or the blood-based perspectives in the central sterile community. Yeah. And the thing that's interesting about that is if you go to somebody and you say, you know, if you got a nosebleed and you get blood on your shirt or something, you know, what do? You go soak it in cold water, you get a little bit of peroxide or something, and it virtually comes out very quickly. So blood in and of itself that's moist or something that comes straight from surgery that still has some kind of liquidity to it is, I hate to say it, is fairly easy, but it is fairly easy to get off. But when you start mixing it with the rest of the body fluids, you know, things that have like a grease base or you know, other types of
synovial fluid, maybe
like synovial fluids, things like this that, you know, are sticky and they're greasy. So when we took this product, we virtually attacked it from a second process. Basically, she said, well, should we be taking these off first and then trying to take the, you know, the blood and the components off first? So when we spec'd the way the product was put together was the degreasing agent or the agent that actually affected grease went in first and in the highest amount. And then the stuff that did the protein and the other stuff followed. So it's a very simple formula. I mean, it's about as simple as you can make it. It doesn't have a whole lot of extra things in it. I've asked this question a lot of time where somebody will put in an anti-corrosive and I'm like, we're dealing with stainless steel and things that shouldn't corrode. So I don't know why it would need an anti-corrosive. So if it's built right, it should probably not need it. But you mentioned the fact that the staff liked it. Well, when we developed it, we actually went into the central sterile community in Fort Saunders Medical Center in Knoxville, Tennessee, and virtually walked in with a bunch of chemicals and filled up a sink and started adding things and starting saying what worked, and actually had SPD staff standing right there with me.
Wow.
You know, washing things and saying what works. Now, to give you how much graciousness they were in that facility was, bear in mind that we were experimenting. So basically everything we did to a piece of equipment, somebody else had to rewash. So we were doubling their amount of work. And one of the things that we hit on when we finally found the right formula was somebody would say, well, why do I have to rewash it? It's beautiful right now. It's clean. It's squeaky. Everything's great. But yet I got to go back and use the other stuff that I don't like. And it's like, well, it doesn't matter. You still have to do the process as you are assigned to do it, you know, in the facility today. But that's how we made it. I tell you, one of my most anecdotal stories that's kind of funny in this is people ask me why it's blue and people ask me why it has the scent. Those were both decided by those individuals in actually two SPD sites. And quite frankly, it was kind of ironic to me. I being a fellow who doesn't have to worry much about, you know, what it looks like or smells like, I'm worried about the chemicals that are in it, which are virtually clear. So
right.
there's no things to those. But I actually had these folks, I brought in some fragrances, I brought in some colors, and I said, you know, you pick them. And I actually had SPD staff members. There were about 16 of them in staff. To tell you frankly, by the time we decided, because I asked them, I said, you know, well, they asked me, they said, what are you going to do with this? And I said, whatever you pick, I'm going to use. I really don't, you know, I don't care. Whatever you think will work, whatever you think smells good. And
that's great.
At the end of the day, I had to do a hidden ballot, because I swear to God, these guys are going to kill each other trying to figure out, you know, everybody had an opinion. And they
were going to convince the other ones that theirs was the best idea, right?
So when someone asked me, you know, why did I make it this way? I mean, I can speak to the chemicals because they work extremely diligently the way I formulated them. But as far as the color and smell, that was all picked by SPD staff members.
Yeah. How about that? That makes sense though, right? Why not? You're testing it with them and you have a little, it's a small sample size, but I mean, you have end users right there that can give you the feedback. I mean, that's fantastic.
And they took it extremely seriously. I mean, this was not something where someone just said, oh yeah, we'll just make it blue. It's like blue actually has a connotation in the fact that, well, this, for instance, why is it blue? It's blue because, number one, when I'm an old chemist, and a chemist, when you used to serially dilute things and you'd take like a tenth of something into another tube, if you did something from a clear tube to a clear tube, you can never really understand if you actually did it. Because if you somebody interrupted you and you went, oh boy, you know, what tube did I start with? Well, if you put a dye in there and you put something in the sink, you're going to see something in the sink. So someone's going to say, did you put the blue 62 in the sink? It's like, well, if it's not blue, you didn't put it in. So.
No, that's a great common sense idea behind that. I think that's really smart and something that maybe not everyone really does think about until maybe the color's gone. You know, if you were dealing with clear products, it might be more of a question like, oh my gosh, did I put this stuff in? I can't remember.
A lot of it speaks to dose because, you know, dose is important in some cases from the fact that some chemicals are made so that they have to be in specific doses. But you mentioned something earlier that was one of the other aspects we had with this development was, you know, we wanted to make it so that if, you know, you could put anything in from a little bit to a lot and, you know, up until the point that you were like completely making it, you know, dark, dark blue or something. I mean, unless you put an awful lot in. We actually tested it as though it was the actual minimum amount that we did for cleanliness. So in other words, you had to add the absolute minimum and you had to prove it cleaned. We also did the opposite of adding, you know, double the actual amount that you could put in and showing that it actually could be rinsed clear. Because one of the primary issues, I believe, this is my own concept, my own conceptual thought of this, it's, you know, people have come up with this before. It's not, you know, a concept that's new to me, but the rinsing aspect of getting materials off of products is probably the largest thing from dose perspective that you can do in the field today. I see a lot of products when I get into a lot of facilities that have, you know, like a, I guess you'd say like a brownish or goldish type of cast to them. And a lot of that comes from either water quality or residuals that are left behind. And a lot of it comes from people trying to do really good work by actually using more soap, you know, more detergent. So if, you know, if it's a little bit's good, a lot's better.
Of course.
And we all think that way. I mean, if you think about this from a, you know, just washing something in your normal sink or something, if it's really hard to get off, you have a little more soap.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay, unless that soap actually doesn't rinse off real well. And if it doesn't rinse off real well and gets left behind, then the next place that it usually happens for us is the autoclave. So if you have a thin film of something and you put it in an autoclave, it tends to fix it onto the surface. And from then on, you've got what we refer to as a buildup. And once you build up over time, it takes a lot to get that off. And it's just something that we've come to live with very well. And, you know, some of the aspects of it is, you know, are we using the right dilutions and the right chemicals that we have to be able to, you know, clean yet still get off the products in an efficient manner. So it's easy for me to tell somebody, you know, I tell this to my engineers all the time. I take them downstairs and they say, well, we just have to rinse it longer. And I said, well, how long are you going to rinse it? Oh, we're going to rinse it for a minute. I said, okay. I hand them a product and I say, start rinsing. And you start timing them and they, you know, they rinse it for like 10 seconds and they start to stop. And you say, well, that's only been 10 seconds. And it's like, okay. So then imagine somebody in your SPD department having to do every one of these pieces for a minute or 2 minutes, every piece for, you know, 60 pieces in a set. And next thing you know, you're rinsing for an hour. No one's got time to do that.
That was a great illustration. I'm glad you showed them that.
Well, I do that a lot. I do that a lot. It's getting people understanding where you are in the field. And we're by far not, you know, unique in this. There's a lot of good device manufacturers that do this over and over all day long. But you know, every once in a while, you've got to bring a little bit of reality down into the engineering world. You know, if we're making something good for a physician and it's got to be cleaned or it's got to be processed over, you've got to convert that world back to their heads to make sure that they're making it so that people can actually get this done.
Yeah, absolutely. So I was wondering, like in your guys' studies, when you were doing the development of this product, you were probably comparing it to things that were already on the market, right? So Were you comparing it to the existing enzymatics? And if so, I mean, were your tests also showing, you know, support that the surfactant was actually more effective than our typical enzymatic products?
Good question.
Yeah. I mean, is that something that you actually measured? Because it was something that sort of anecdotally, I'm telling you, my staff was saying, yeah, this thing is better, you know. But did you get any sort of objective measurement that said, oh, yeah, this is actually better?
Certainly. And I can give you a real kick. I still can remember in, I want to say it's 2016 or 17. I presented at the Isham conference, and I was known at the time as an enzyme hater. I mean, basically, you know, I'd stand on the podium and I'd say, you know, these things are bad. And I can tell you that the enzyme manufacturers didn't like that very well. And I thought I knew something. Well, we're all capable of learning more and learning what we need to know better. And I was approached by some folks, some very diligent folks who could have just, you know, dusted me off as saying, you know, he's the guy that's going to sell one thing and he doesn't worry about us. But enzyme manufacturers actually came to me and showed me, you know, their products. And I can tell you that, and I'm a big advocate of this. And even though I sell, you know, a detergent that's non-enzymatic, I believe every institution should have a non-enzymatic and an enzymatic detergent. And the enzymes are for the purposes they're built for. Enzymes are a catalyst. They're a chemical natured product that assists in cleaning. And believe me, they do assist in cleaning. The issues we talked about earlier about rinsing, where you wouldn't want to rinse for 30 seconds for every piece. If you convert that with how long you need to actually give the enzymes time to soak, and the enzyme manufacturer will tell this to you, you know, it's, if you're thinking of something like a laundry machine where something's sitting in a tub and it's sitting there for X amount of time in water and it's working, those enzymes work extremely effective. They can do the same thing in the medical device world, but they have to have time. So when you're trying to clean something quickly and it's an efficient way to clean with a non-enzymatic cleaner that we make and others make as well, you know, your surfactants should be powerful enough to be able to clean things off easily. Now, if you've got, you know, small areas, or if you've got very hard places to get to, the most common thing that comes to mind is flexible endoscopes, which everyone wants to talk about. But they were built for the enzyme world. In other words, if you set something in and it soaks for X amount of time and you have the right enzyme and you have the right conditions, enzymes are extremely powerful and are extremely good. But again, it takes, I guess you'd say, some care and actual knowledge of the use of these things to make them work well. We found that when we made one without an enzyme and we were actually fighting against them, you know, the enzyme makers would come back to us and say, but, you know, you're missing the power of the enzyme. And it's like, that's actually true. But I would also come back to the enzyme makers and say, well, if I'm making a, you know, a powered piece of equipment, which if I wanted to have them think right, you know, think of something like your dual drill that you have at home, you know, you're not going to stick that in your washing machine, or you're not going to stick that, you know, outside, you know, and let it get rained on or something, because things need to be protected. But in a powered tool perspective, that's what happens in surgery. I mean, if you're going to put it in a washer, it's got to go through a washer. If you're going to put it in a sink and you want to get it clean, you can't soak it for 10 minutes. So you can't use an enzyme effectively because it just doesn't have enough time for those enzymes to, the enzymes don't really do you any good. I mean, they're not there, but yet a lot of other tools, they're extremely effective for used in the right way. So I've changed my process now. I'm not an enzyme hater anymore. I'm a use of appropriately enzymes.
Yeah. You just helped me understand, at least I think, sort of the why there might be a need for both. Because one astute sales rep quickly pointed out to me that I was not compliant with certain IFUs because those certain IFUs call out specifically for enzymatic cleaners, which they actually weren't wrong about that. There's a certain robotic instrument manufacturer that calls out for enzymes, but they also call for soaking those instruments for periods of time, which then makes sense, right? If you're going to use an enzymatic detergent to then soak it and give it that time that it needs, whereas we're all using power equipment as well, and maybe that enzymatic doesn't work to the best of what we want for that application. So then, therefore, there's this need for a surfactant or a different type of product. Right. That's great, because I was sort of out hunting for that answer with this conversation. And I hope that that helps, you know, listeners kind of connect the dots a little bit, because, you know, as a manager, I'm trying to simplify the process and make things a lot more repeatable and do that as much as I possibly can. And it was so exciting to see this detergent come out that didn't need temperature, didn't, you know, the dilution was easy to manage, all this stuff. And on top of that, they loved it. So it was like, all right, using this for everything, you know? And to my knowledge, it probably did work for everything, but I can see now that just like you, like there's a place for these enzymatics, and maybe we need to be more flexible and more pinpointed in that we want to use the right product for the right application type of thing.
You hit the nail on the head. That's my always been my contention is a non-enzymatic solution can be used for a lot of things. And I mean, a lot. I mean, there's the other side of this coin is that for many, many years, we've all been told that you have to use an enzyme for everything because they help cleaning. And the honest answer to that is they do. They absolutely do. There's absolutely no doubt about the fact that an added enzyme will assist in cleaning the proper way. The issue we have in the central sterile community is the fact that if you had enough time, as I mentioned with rinsing, if you had enough time to do everything the way the enzyme was properly made to be done, you'd be switching your sinks a lot faster. You'd be measuring your temperatures a lot easier. You'd be soaking things for a lot longer. Unfortunately, as we all know, reality doesn't always work that way. So I tell people all the time, it's like, don't visit a central sterile area at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning. Get them at like 9:30, 10, when the case carts actually start coming back. Then you're going to see you need to be effective and efficient, not shortcutting from the standpoint, I would never say not to do things effective. But as you just said, you know, a powerful surfactant cleaner that doesn't necessarily need all of those extra steps to ensure its usefulness is very effective in cleaning a large majority of equipment. And especially if it's made so that it's produced to clean the types of things that we have to get off surgical tools. I mean, if it's made to just clean blood easily enough, that's fine. But if it's formulated enough to take all of those things that we use, you know, in the surgery field, and we talk about a lot of times about that being dried on, but, you know, I've done my own time studies from a perspective that you know, you can't keep something that's, you know, that starts on a 3 or 4 hour surgery very moist if it's been sitting on a Mayo stand or on a back table for 3 hours before it gets treated. I mean, it's already been dried on harder than you can possibly imagine. So you need something that effectively can punch that through. So that's what the chemicals should be designed to do, is to actually help people clean.
Yeah, absolutely. Because as much as we really, really push for a point of use care and wiping down of the instruments, but the bottom line is I've scrubbed total joints, and not that you can't do a good job of the point of use care, but there's always going to be exceptions where there are going to be items in your sterile field that don't get that love and attention that they should, and that's always going to be a possibility. And so, like you said, I think having the right product for the right application in those long surgeries, I mean, you're going to have instances where the stuff does get dried on there, you know, and it's not ideal, but at least now maybe we have some things in our arsenal that can take care of it.
Yeah. I guess the biggest perspective that I have for most people is for years, we've been looking for one product that serves all needs.
Yes.
I buy one thing and everything works. I just got to tell people that you know, it takes a little bit of pre-thought to what you have. And we have some very, very good and intelligent people that are working in the SPD department that people give little credit to. But when you're in a decontam area and you're suited up and you're asking people to make, you know, tons of decisions, they don't really need to make tons of decisions. They just need to be given the tools appropriately. They know how to make the right decision and they can work with those products well. But, you know, The worst thing I think I can hear when I go into a department is someone who is very good at cleaning things and their answer is, you know, I use this because somebody else bought it for me. It's like, no, I mean, you should be given the opportunity to pick the things that you know work. Cost is always an item, but the cost of something that works is still much better than the cost of something that doesn't. So.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Right on with that. I mean, we always... You know, I think it's Steven who always says, you know, the quality doesn't cost, it pays, you know, and this is all about quality, whether it's a quality detergent or quality cleaning process, quality sterilization process, whatever it is. That's our role in the medical device processing world, is to produce a quality product and a safe product for the patients. And so it's just frustrating because, you know, in the reality of you know, managing a sterilization department, we have contracts. We have things that people decide on and sign the dotted line, and they don't have that clinical background. They don't necessarily know that, hey, you know, there are reasons that we're going with this. And a lot of times those voices are drowned out by the dollars. It's unfortunate, but that's the reality we live in. And we have to do a better job of arguing our case, getting a seat at the table, all of those things.
Well, I'd agree with you. And especially if you go to bat for somebody saying, well, now I need to order two instead of one. You know, someone's going to say, well, why do you need two? And it's like, well, I need to have the right tools to do the right process. That'll get you home in a lot of cases. But I do understand the fact that, you know, that there's a lot of players when they get into this market as far as who's controlling what. And like I said, my job is, Stephen has said it to me before, was, you know, the people that understand what needs to be done to get clean is the people that do the cleaning. So they should be the first ones that are consulted on that aspect for what they need. And what we as manufacturers, and myself being a, you know, I'm a device manufacturer. I have been all my life. I just celebrated my 25th year with Stryker. Before that, I spent 18 years in toxicology research. You know, it's been a very, very long career. But what I found in this is it's probably one of the least produced, studied materials that I've seen in the SPD market. In other words, when you look at something like laundry detergent, and you try to Google, you know, articles on laundry detergent, you may get 30, 40,000 hits because somebody like Procter & Gamble or Whirlpool or you know, they study these things over and over again. But yet you'll Google something for like medical device detergents and you'll get, you know, 3,000 hits, you know, and most of them will be on everything that somebody's doing bad to not clean devices. There's very little solution documentation out there that, and I don't mean solution meaning a chemical, I mean things that actually are solutions to cleaning products. I mean, there's very little study out there from that perspective. And I can't say that we're great at it either, but we've at least, you know, if I can do anything more for the device world, it's to get all of us that make solutions to do more testing and get more of that testing and data to the actual users in the field so they can make an appropriate decision. And if, by God, mine doesn't make it, then somebody else will, then it won't matter because it'll at least make somebody's job easier in getting proper tools done. So,
yeah, absolutely. I appreciate that. And, you know, you made me just think of something maybe for further research or studying is, you know, the use of a surfactant detergent in automated washers as opposed to enzymatics, only because a lot of times we're looking at, with enzymes, we're looking at that contact time, that soak time, and automated process. I'm not sure that counts as a soak time.
Yeah, and it's a good comment because it isn't the difference, the fact that, again, it doesn't go back to the fact that the enzymes don't work. It's a question of what enzymes they are. And in automated processes are very much able to be controlled. I mean, there's a lot of enzymes that get used in dish detergent and laundry detergent, but they're specifically made that way. So I would say that one of the things that is a telling fact for me sometimes is when someone sees a detergent and it says, we'll use this for automated and this for manual. And I kind of go back to my thinking saying, you know, I'm not going to use my Palmolive dish soap in my dishwasher because they're completely different sciences that get worked.
Right.
So I'm not quite understanding the case of the same material being, you know, if it's your automated detergent, you shouldn't be able to just dump less in it and make it a manual detergent. They work differently. So
yeah,
hopefully that gets across to people. So
yeah, no, that's great. And you know, Rod, it's hard to believe that this conversation has already gone on for almost 35 minutes and I'm already running out of time with you. And I apologize for that, but I just want to thank you so much for being a part of this. And maybe at some point down the road, maybe there's a number two episode of this, but just wanted to thank you so much for joining me on this.
No problem. It's been a pleasure. You know, here to help, trying to do the best things we can. So whatever we can do to help people in that community, better off we're all going to be.
Well, we appreciate it. Okay, what a great interview with Rod Parker, Senior Principal Scientist at Stryker. Rod shared with us some of the behind-the-scenes story that went into the development of Stryker's Blue 62 detergent. He also challenged our thinking a little bit. Is there one enzymatic detergent that is best for cleaning all types of surgical devices? Perhaps a better way would be to use the best detergent for the application. Maybe the best practice would be to have an arsenal in Decontam that includes both enzymatic and surfactant-based detergents. Let us know what you think about this by emailing your thoughts or comments to asktheeducator@hmark.com. I want to thank you all for listening, and don't forget to subscribe to our podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. All opinions expressed on this show are those of the presenters. Before using any medical device, it is important to review the device manufacturer's instructions for use.